The Holy Gospel is found in the book of Luke, the second chapter. When the time came for Mary and baby Jesus' purification according to the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary went to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer, night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they'd finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord. I'd like to invite the children up for the children's message. Well, I want to ask the question, who did Jesus come for? As we look at the Bible, who are the people that the angels spoke to, that recognized who Jesus was? And what does that tell us about who Jesus comes for today? So we're going to take a look at a few of those people. The first ones, of course, are Zechariah and Elizabeth. Elizabeth is Mary's cousin. Zechariah was a priest in the synagogue. And some of you heard this story on Christmas. We didn't use it at all the services. But Zechariah was in the holiest place. And he was setting the altar, getting ready, and praying to God. And Gabriel appeared to him. Now, what you need to know about Zechariah and Elizabeth is that they were old. That's all the Bible says. I think it's more entertaining to say they were older than dirt, but I don't know if that's nice. But Elizabeth was definitely, the Bible tells us, past childbearing years. And the angel Gabriel said to Zechariah, "Elizabeth, your wife, is going to have a baby, and you're going to name him John." So then the angel struck Zechariah dumb for the whole 9 months of the pregnancy. None of you wives are allowed to imagine what a wonder that would be, okay? No, I'm kidding. Okay, that's the last sexist thing I'll say today, I swear. It might not be the last one, I think. But this year, yeah, that's right, my last one for the year. But Elizabeth gets pregnant. 6 months after Elizabeth is pregnant, the angel Gabriel came to Mary and said to Mary, "You are favored of God. You're going to have a child. You will name him Jesus. He is the Messiah. He will be for the salvation of the people. He will be God with us, Emmanuel." And Mary, I just love Mary's response, because she didn't say, "Are you kidding? I'm a virgin." She said, "Let it be done to me according to your word." And so then Mary went to be with Elizabeth for a while. So, and the angel Gabriel also appeared to Joseph and said, "I know that Mary is not, you guys are engaged, but you're not together that way, but she's pregnant. And don't put her away. You keep her." Are you raising your hand? Oh, I'm sorry. I thought that would be really entertaining if this became a Q&A. sorry, back. So the angel Gabriel, so we can look at those four people and say, who were they? Well, we know that Zechariah was a religious insider, because he was a priest in the synagogue who got to go into the holiest part of the synagogue. He was descended from the tribe of Levi. They were the people who did the religious work. So Zechariah and Elizabeth together were probably religious insiders. Then we have Mary and Joseph. He's a carpenter. We know that. I think I've told you the story about when I taught kindergarten Sunday school once. Have I told you this? And the first week of class was about how Jesus helped his dad in the carpenter shop, which it doesn't actually say in the Bible, but that was the lesson. So I had the kids draw a picture of a promise they could make to help at home that week, like Jesus did. So most of the kids, 5 years old, you know, they drew pictures of making their bed or setting the table. One little girl drew a picture I couldn't figure out at all. It didn't track with me. And so I said, "Michelle, why don't you describe your picture for us?" And she said, "Well, my mom is in the hospital getting a new baby today, and I promise when she gets at home, I'm going to suck it up with the vacuum cleaner." No lie, that's what the picture was. Jesus was born to a carpenter and to a young woman, a very young woman. And the long reading that we read from Luke tells us that the sacrifices that they brought to the altar of God were two turtle doves. That was the sacrifice designated for people who were in poverty. So Mary and Joseph didn't have a lot. They made the minimum sacrifice required, because that's all they could do. So we know that God came to religious insiders. We know that God came to people who were living in poverty. Then Jesus came to the shepherds. The angel came to the shepherds. So Jesus came for the shepherds. The shepherds would have been like outsiders. And I don't mean just living outside. I mean they would have been seen as the lowest of the social scale. They were dealing with things that kind of perpetually kept them ritually unclean. And so that the angels came in a huge chorus to them and sang the birth of Jesus tells us that exactly what we heard in Titus is exactly what God was doing in the coming of Jesus. Jesus came to abolish the laws that kept us from God, that said, you can't, God is not here for you, or you must earn God's favor if you do these things, right? And Jesus came to totally abolish that. God coming, the angels coming to the shepherds tells us that. Then the wise men. Now, the wise men were the only group of people that God announced the birth of Jesus to who were not Jewish. The wise men came from the east. They were of another religion, probably Zoroastrianism. And they came, and the star directed them. So God directed people who were not part of the people of Israel. That becomes really important in the formation of the church after the death of Jesus. Who's in? And that's why the verses in Titus are so important, that God came to the people who were under the law to set them free, to let them know that it's the glorious grace of God. So God came to people who would not have been seen as God's people in those days. And then finally, we heard the songs and the words of Simeon and Anna. Now, if you've been a Lutheran a long time, you recognize the words of Simeon. They're called the Nunc Dimittis. Now, Dimittis. Now let your servants go in peace. We often used to, 20 years ago, sing that at the end of a worship service. Now you let your servants go in peace because our eyes have seen the salvation that you prepared before the foundation of the world. Those are the words that Simeon heard, and those are the words that Titus echoes. God comes not to make us better, holier, gooder people. God comes because we aren't, any of us. That's what this story tells us. Every single one of us in the whole world needs a Savior. We need somebody to come and say, in the middle of all of the wonderful things that you do as human beings, and in the middle of all of the broken things, in the middle of the brokenness of the world, in the middle of the confusion of war and distress, in the middle of all of the things that you worry about and that you're concerned about, in the middle of all of those things comes this baby who is the Savior of the world, who comes for you. So I invite you to think this week, as you think about the story of Christmas, who would you be in that story? Maybe you would be one of those people. Maybe you would be a shepherd. I'm pretty sure I would be an angel. But maybe you would be a shepherd. Maybe you would be Mary, because God has spoken to you in unusual ways and you know that you are able to be obedient. Maybe you'd be Joseph, kind of a bit player, but a really important bit player. Maybe you're one of those religious people like Anna, who, it says Anna lived in the synagogue. We kind of don't have anyone living here, but maybe you feel like you live here. Jesus comes for all of us. This is the great good news. So who are you that Jesus comes for? That's the question for this week. Amen.